And as I came, your aroma, Yah Yisrael, Yah, come forth to speak to the house. Let us greet him for hearty hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Isn't Yahweh tough today? Hallelujah. He has awakened us this morning. It was by no strength of our own. Hallelujah. It was not by your own strength that you open your eyes, because there are times where it seems like it's hard to open those eyes when you want to awaken. There's times when you want to go to sleep, and it's hard to go to sleep, isn't it true? So it is Yahweh that gives us rest. It is Yahweh that allows us to sleep, and it's him that gives us his shalom. He gives his beloved shalom in their sleep, and he has awakened us this morning. I do barak Yahweh for all things, for all you conditions that have gathered with us here at Teshu Community, and all those that are listening by via live stream. If you have heard, many of you may know that Reuch Dawid, he is in Duluth, Georgia, with Elder Lewis. They're conducting a service there. I pray that all is well, that conditions will come out to hear the truth. We must be of a like mind, conditions of Yahweh, that we desire to hear the word of Yahweh. Even though it cuts us, it wounds us, and it hurts sometimes, we should desire that Yahweh will bring forth anything that is within us out that is not of him. Because if this process does not happen now, it's not going to happen when we pass from this life. And as I continue in this message concerning being born of Yah, it's important that we understand this. We must be born again of Yahweh now. The transformation has happened, it must have happened, and it must happen. Because if it doesn't take place, if we're not real with Yahweh now, when we come to our latter days, when we pass from this life, anything that remains in you shall be there when you arise. When it's time for judgment, it's going to be there. Whether if the judgment of Yahweh is to your benefit or whether it's to your damnation, anything that is left within you when you die in this life, it's going to go before you unto judgment. So what is this born again experience? I preached this message, teach this message a few weeks ago, because I heard of some that say, well, we cannot cease from sin while we dwell in the flesh. And that is not true. Have not Yahweh endowed us, Yisrael, with his Ruach HaKodesh? Is it the same Ruach HaKodesh that dwelled in Yahshua HaMashiach? Or is it something different? Has it lost its power? Has it lost its meaning? Has it lost its effect, Yisrael? No, it has not. But it is us. If we continue to walk in the realm of this flesh, fulfilling the desire of the flesh, we somewhat make the word of Yahweh of none effect. That is what has happened unto us, house of Yisrael. We have not continued in the direction or the path that Yahweh has already cut for us to walk in. But we want to walk in this broad path where anything goes. Don't anything go? Basically, anything goes in the world. It doesn't take much for you to be examined or acknowledged as a worldly person or wicked. A wicked person look at another wicked person, man, I know I'm bad, but man, he's worse than me. But even the one that's saying that know that he is a sinner, that he is not right. You got those who confess, man, I know I'm not right, but I won't kill a man. You got those that justify their righteousness even though they know that they're not right with Yah. So that path of that way is broad. Is it not right? Broad is the way that leadeth unto death and separation from Yah. But narrow is this direct or this path that leadeth unto eternal life. And you're not going to find many in this path. That those that want to bring on the luggage of the world and the weights of the world and think they can fit down this path, it's not so. Because if you're walking through the woods, those of you that are hunters that have this experience, when you follow a deer's path, it's very narrow. When you track it, they go through the briskets or the briars, small trees. When they're in hiding, you're not going to see them out in the middle of the field or walking down the highway. When they're hiding, they know that their safety is in that narrow path. And most, all deer basically take the same path, because you can see what? You can see the wear. You can see the tear in that narrow path. So it is also with the house of Yisrael. Our safety is in this narrow path. This path of Yahweh's Dabar. And it's not for us to take on excess baggage. It's not for us to take what we think is going to sustain us in this life, because Yahshua sustains us. It is in Yahshua that we find all that we need. So we don't have to look any farther. We can stop looking around searching for another way or another path or an easier direction. There's only one way. And that is walking in the path, the same path that Yahshua HaMashiach. We see how he walked throughout scripture. He obeyed his Abba. Is not his Abba our Abba? Have we not been grafted into the same tree? We're in the family tree, as so many say we're in the family tree. We've been rooted and grafted in. So we must follow the same walk he walked. We must face the same things he faced. Even unto the stake or unto the cross, because this is of Yahweh. He was bruised. He was battered. And he suffered what? He suffered shame and ridicule. For who? For what? For us. Hallelujah. So why would we not do all that has been given us through the power of Yahshua, that has been given us through the Torah of Yahweh, not by our own flesh, because we're not going to make it that way. It's only by what? What we hear and what we understand through the Ruah HaKodesh. So Yahweh Baraki, all the listed conditions of Yahweh, I want to somewhat retract on some of the previous scriptures that I have read concerning being born of Yahweh. And I want to start with the part of sinning willfully. Sinning willfully. After we have come into the knowledge of the truth, you know, many times, even in our fleshly walk, you know, Yahweh in man has given man a Torah. Even the wicked of those know what is right and what is wrong. It is put there, if I may say, human nature. You know what is right. Even through your family, even through traditions, they have taught you or put you on a basis that, no, son, it's wrong to lie. I believe everyone that had some kind of parenting knows that they taught you not to lie. Even though you may have done that or been called in it, they reproved you and say, no, you shouldn't lie. Why? Because it's not right. It is a sin. They're giving you a Torah of instruction. And if you follow that Torah of instruction, you will find life in that. You'll be one that has some kind of integrity amongst people, that your word will stand if you did not lie. But if you find a liar, there is no integrity. Hallelujah. So we should not sin willfully after we have received the knowledge or the understanding of what is true. Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 10, verse 26. And some of these, many of these verses are the same verses. But I want to excite us. I want us to be reminded, because this is of Yahweh, because we are people that must have to continually be reminded, hallelujah, that we do not forget what Yahweh is instructing us. It says in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 26, for if we sin willfully, what is willfully? Willfully is doing what you want to do. Even though you know it's wrong, that those that told you that it's wrong, you know it's wrong to steal, there's a cake in the refrigerator or ice cream and you know it's not yours. Daddy and mama said, you better not touch that cake, boy. Girl, don't go on that ice cream. Instead, you find yourself going in and then touching that which was commanded of you not to touch, after you know you should not touch it. You know, I may use examples like that, but that's, you know, that's a serious matter of the conditions of Yahweh. But we are still children. We are the children of Almighty Yahweh, are we not? And we still yet do childish things. So let me continue reading. If we sin willfully after that we have received the knowledge of what? The truth. There remains no offering, or it says here, no sacrifice for sins or for the sin. Do we understand the judgment in that conditions of Yahweh? Once Yahshua HaMashiach, the labor that he suffered in his body, even unto the stake, all that he has done, he did it for us, even his death at the stake, at the cross, on that hill called Golgotha. And yet, that sacrifice was for the sins of every man. that there will be no excuse. That sacrifice or that offering to man will never be offered again. There's only one chance. There's only one offering given unto man. The body of Yahshua will never be offered again in that fashion. The way he was whipped, the way he was beaten, we should receive that punishment upon our back. It was us that sinned before Almighty Yahweh. It was not Yahshua HaMashiach, but yet he was the offering. He stood in a proxy for us. Hallelujah. If that don't mean something to you, Yisrael, then you might as well give up this walk. You might as well stop being a hypocrite. You might as well just go into the world and do your thing. Because this is real. Throughout scripture, we see continuously as offering after offering, sacrifice after sacrifice, the life of goats, of sheep. Why? Because that was in the Torah of Moshe for the remission of sin. But all that has been done away with because of the offering of Yahshua HaMashiach, and yet we trample that, his precious blood. What happened to that conviction of the blood? The blood that Yahshua shed for me way back on Mount Calvary. The dawn that gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power. It reaches to the highest mountain. Oh, it reaches there. And it flows. Who is in the lowest valley? To the lowest valley. The dawn that gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power. It is by that same dove, Yisrael. It's only by the blood of Yahshua HaMashiach. You know, I remember, as my mind kind of goes back, my avat, as we call him, Evangelist Horn, he would sing that song. I haven't heard anyone that sing it like him. Hallelujah. But we can sing that song, Yisrael. Talking about the dam of Yahshua. Why? Because it has been shed for each and every one of us. Hallelujah. Have we forgot about the dam? Don't you know when that blood touched you and it washed you? Do you remember that day? There was a transformation that day. You knew that you were not the same. Hallelujah. You didn't desire the same things. You didn't want to do those old things anymore. The things that caused you heartache, the things that caused you pain, you knew they were not right. But for some reason, you could not stop doing them until that blood came, until you realized the dam of Yahshua. The dam of Yahshua was shed for your sins. And what are you? What were you? What are you? The scripture said that you were made a new creation. You was born again. Do we remember that, Yisrael? Have we forgotten that experience? Are there those of us that have not experienced that and do not understand that? Hallelujah. What is it to be born of Yah? As I quote the scripture many times, and we'll get into that. Those who are born of Yah, they cannot sin. They do not sin, Yisrael. So from that time, have we progressed? Have we grown? Or have we regressed? Have we, as they say, have we backslid? Have we fallen, Yisrael? Well, I want you to know that same dam is still alive today. Hallelujah. So let us sue. Let us turn unto Yahweh. Let us turn unto Yahshua, the only offering given unto man. But don't you know this, Yisrael? Yahweh hears not mocked. For whatever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Even though that is a beautiful action that Yahshua HaMashiach has done for us is for us to walk in righteousness. It's for us to come out of darkness and not to walk anymore in the light. So what has he given us to sustain us? He's given us his word. He's given us those with the Ruach to come, to speak, to encourage, to proclaim his word, to rebuke, to reprove, to exhort, with all longsuffering and doctrine. What is that doctrine? It is to walk in the light of Yah. It's to obey Yahweh in everything he has commanded of Yisrael Yah. But as I read, the Dodam Yahshua, Yahshua being our offer, being our sacrifice, being our mediator between us and the Abba, he stands there. It says here, as I read, there remains no more sacrifices for the sin. There's no more sacrifice for the sin. Once you come to the knowledge of that sin, and your iniquity, you know it's not right to backslide or to do that thing, and you do that thing. The scripture says there remain no more sacrifice. Yahweh is not going to allow us to trample the Dam of Yahshua afresh. He's the only offering that's going to be given. Verse 27. But it says, but a certain fearful looking for judgment and fiery indignation which shall fall, which shall devour the adversaries. He that despiseth the Moshe's Torah, they died without mercy under two or three witnesses. We deserve the death penalty, Yisrael Yah. Two or three witnesses? Under the Torah of Moshe? You died. You think you went to the Shemayims after you died? No. There's an everlasting judgment of the burning of hell. Damnation. Separation from Almighty Yahweh. But look what's done through Yahshua HaMashiach. He allows us time after time, chance after chance. And I will get into that because I want us to understand something. You know, isn't that something how we could take the Torah, the pure word of Yahweh, and we try to use it to our advantage? To try to twist the word of Yahweh to suit our purposes and our needs, what we want to believe, that we can feel comfortable and where we are in our position, standing in our flesh. We allow the flesh to rise up. Now, haven't we done that, Yisrael Yah? Well, there's a scripture that says that a Siddiq man or a righteous man, have you heard that quoted? He falls seven times. It's all right for one to sin. Because the scripture says a righteous man, a Siddiq man, falls seven times. But that's twisting the scripture, Yisrael Yah. There's more to it than just that. And I will get into that as I somewhat conclude this message today. I don't plan to be before us long, Yisrael Yah, because I know this is the Shabbat of Yahweh, and I want us to rest, but yet we should rest in the Ruach. This should be our rest, hearing the Torah of Yahweh, comforting our minds. You know, this is a day we should come into the house of Yahweh with no burdens, no worries, but yet we have come into the house of Yahweh with things on our mind. It's just the truth, Yisrael Yah. So Yahweh sends his Dabar what? What, to lift those burdens. Forget about those thoughts. Why? Because he has control of all things, and everything will be all right, Yisrael Yah. So I will get in that concerning the righteous of the Siddiq man falleth seven times. But under Moses' Torah, or the Torah of Moshe, they died without any mercies under two or three witnesses. And it says in the 10th chapter, 29th verse, of how much sorer punishment, how much sorer of a punishment or worse of a punishment should be exacted unto us, Yisrael Yah? If you recall me reading about the man that was lame, that was trying to get down to the waters, but because of his circumstances and because the way his body was ridden, he could not get to the water when the Melechim come to touch it, that he may be healed. Well, Yahshua helped him, that he was healed, that he was made whole. But yet Yahshua said unto him, to what? To go and sin no more, lest a worse thing. Don't you know there's a worse thing in store for us? There's a worse judgment. It is better that we have never received this knowledge of Yahshua HaMashiach and the offering unto our sins, that to receive that knowledge and then trample it. or to turn our back. So it says here, how much sower punishment? Suppose you think about it, that he be thought worthy of who has trodden underfoot the Son of Almighty Yahweh. How can we do that? How can we trodden underfoot the Son of Almighty Yahweh after what he has done for us, Yisra'iyah? And has counted the dam, the blood of the covenant. Don't you know that was Yahweh's covenant unto Yisra'iyah? Don't you know there was no other way for our sins to be washed, to be cleansed away from us, but by the dam of Yahshua? And has counted the dam, the blood of Yahshua, of that covenant, wherein he was made Kodesh, and unkodesh thing, and has done despite to the Ruach of a merited pardon. Don't you know the pardon of Yahweh was a merited? It was to everyone who believed in Yahshua HaMashiach. Verse 30. For we know him that has said, vengeance belong to me. He said, I will recompense, said Almighty Yahweh. You don't want to fall into the hands of Almighty Yahweh. Not into Almighty Yahweh. Not when he's angered. You know, that angers Yahweh more than anything. That once we have come to the knowledge, we have been washed from our sins for us to go back and to trample the dam of Yahshua HaMashiach. He said, he will recompense, saith Yahweh, again. Yahweh shall judge his people. So there's a judgment waiting for those that turn. Turn from Almighty Yahweh. Turn from the offering of the dam of Yahshua HaMashiach. Verse 31. It says that it is a fearful. What happened to the fear? What happens when we sin so many times after we, if I may use this term, been born again, and we find ourselves backsliding or backslidden, we're back in the same path where we once were. Don't you know that it is a fearful thing? It says in verse 31 of Hebrews 10, it is a fearful thing. What happened to the fear? Why are we not afraid of the judgment? It's a fearful thing to fall into the hands. It says to fall. How many of you have failed before? It's an embarrassing thing when there are those that have seen you fall. You trip over something, or you tumble. You lose your balance. Once you, in that split second between that trip and before you hit the ground, there's nothing you can do. It's hard to recover from a real trip. It's hard to recover from that. So if we fall into the hands of Yahweh, how are we going to be recovered? If we trip, the scriptures say that our sin and our iniquity are our stumbling blocks. So if we're still sinning, committing iniquity in the eyes of Yahweh, it says here, it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living Yahweh. Because we will be judged, Yisra'iyah. We will be judged. Our sins, the things that we hoard in our bodies, we think no one knows. Yes, someone knows. Yahweh knows. And you may get away with it for a time. You may laugh about it, you know, because nobody saw you, think no one saw you. But you know that the eyes of Yahweh goes to and fro. He knows all things, Yisra'iyah. Just because someone doesn't see you physically don't mean there's no judgment. If you could do that, then you don't fear Yah. There's no transformation. Because once we have been transformed, changed, transformed, made new, brand new, there's no way we can go back to our old ways or transgress or do those old things. Hallelujah. But yet in all and in all, I told the Yahweh for his mercies, for his kindness, and for the dam of Yahshua HaMashiach. Because even though we fall, and I will get into that, I want us to understand, it's not for us to continually fall in the same act. That's not what it's for. I will get there because there's a beautiful thing. It uses the number 7. It didn't say 1, 4, 10, or 12. It said 7. And there's an important reason why it said 7. And I know that in this teaching, I will not get into the depths of it. But if I can just somewhat skim the top so we can just get a little something today, then that would suit my ruach. Hallelujah. I have accomplished what I have gotten up here to do, Yisrael. Hallelujah. Let us continue in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Chapter 15, verse 51 to 54. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Are you with me, Israel? Hallelujah. Told Yahweh. It says in 1 Corinthians, chapter 15, verse 51. He says, behold, I show you a mystery. I show you something that cannot be fulfilled or understood by the flesh. I show you a mystery, that we should not all sleep, but we shall be changed. Now, this is talking about at the last trump, after the judgments of Yahweh has been wrought in the earth, as we have read in Revelation many times, that we shall be changed. This change is being changed from this mortal flesh into immortality. And as I have read and I have exclaimed to us, the scripture also said, and I hope that I did, and I'll be able to find it. The scripture also says that he that is filthy, let him be filthy still. Hallelujah. But he that is kodesh, or that are siddiq, righteous, let him be righteous still. Now, this is the changing. So this is somewhat to debunk that theory that when we are changed from this body, then we will be, or we will experience that born-again experience by where we won't sin anymore. And that's why I expressed to us so many times, no, this must happen. That's why we're here. That we can work the works of Yahshua HaMashiach, and that's walking in the completeness of the Torah of Almighty Yahweh, and to do it, to please him in all things, and to not sin. Well, who was the one that sinned from the beginning? It was Satan. Did he not sin from the beginning? Was he not a liar and the father of it? Hallelujah. Was he a spirit? Or was he in a flesh body? He was a spirit. Let us continue in Corinthians. Let me start at verse 51 again. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. It says, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. So this change is going to happen. Words can really cannot express the speed of it, but it will be an instant thing. We'll be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. It says, at the last, so far, the last blowing of the trumpet. You know, that's a powerful word, last, whether you realize it or not. Last. It means it's the last. There's no more after it. It's the last. So at the last shofar, for the shofar shall sound, and all the dead shall be rise incorruptible. And we shall be changed. It says all the dead shall be risen incorruptible. Verse 53. For this corruptible must put on incorruption. It's talking about this flesh. For the flesh cannot stand before Almighty Yahweh. And neither shall any flesh enter into the Melkut or into the kingdom. Is that not right? So we must be changed from this corruptible. It must put on incorruption. And this mortal must put on immortality. Verse 54. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, that death is swallowed up in victory. This is showing the transformation of this body, being corrupt, to incorruption. That is corruptible. Being made so that it cannot be corrupted, Yisrael Yah. So in that we do understand that there is a time that is coming where we shall be changed. And once this change takes forth or takes place, it cannot be reversed. It won't be reversed. Why? Because as the scripture said, because it is the last, at the last shofar, that this is going to happen. So let me go to this chapter, chapter 22, verse 11, concerning. Let me go up a few scriptures. I like to do that so that we kind of understand somewhat the basis. Sometimes when you go just a few scriptures up, it gives you somewhat of a better understanding. And sometimes you may have to go a few chapters. It just depends. So let me start at verse 8. It says, "And I, Yochanan, saw these things and heard them. And when I had heard and seen," not only did he hear, but he saw them, "I fell down to worship before the feet of the Moloch, which showed me these things. Then said he unto me, See thou, do not bow down to worship me. I'm just a Melechim. I am also like unto you a worshiper," what he going to exclaim, "for I am thy fellow servant." Isn't that something to know? That there are Melechim that are our fellow comrades, fellow servants. Though we may not see them with this physical eye, but scripture also said that we should, be aware. Unless you entertain one and you do not know it. This is a real thing, Israel. He said, "I am your fellow servant and of your brethren, the prophets," it says, "and of them which keep the sayings of this book, we all worship Yahweh." And he said unto me, "Seal not the sayings of this prophecy, of this book, for the time is at hand." It is very near. And it says this, "The time is very near," or "it is at hand. He that is unjust." He that is unjust. Do you understand what unjust is? What it means? Not right. Not walking in the Torah. Breaking the commandments of Yahweh. "He that is unjust, let him be unjust." What does it say? Still. Still. So if you're unjust, even at that last trumpet, when this transformation takes place, no matter who you are, no matter your status, it doesn't matter how much money you have or where you stand in this world. When this change comes, you're going to be unjust still. "And he which is filthy." So now we done gone from being unjust to being filthy. "He that is filthy, let him be filthy." What did it say? Still. Still. "And he that is righteous," Siddiq, "full of the Ruach of Almighty Yahweh, walking in his Dabar, has been changed, been transformed, born again. He that is righteous, let him be righteous still." Let's let this judge our lives, Yisrael. Are we ready? I remember back in the days of my youth, you would hear this question often. If Yahshua came today, let's say if we knew he was coming the next couple of hours, what would you do? We'll all be on our faces, would we not? We'll all be searching our lives. If we knew that he was coming in the next 10 minutes, would we have time to get it all right? Well, Yahweh has given us a space of time to repent, Yisrael. So whatever that thought that just went through your mind, and that sin that you said, that you pointed out, that you know is there, and that thing that is unclean, that came up in your conscience, you better get right before Yahweh now, today. For now is the acceptable time of Almighty Yahweh. Hallelujah. It should have been when that question was asked that there was a reassurance that, yes, I am clean. There's no sins. Yahshua has washed all my sins. There's nothing that will go before me. There was nothing that will go behind me that can wreck or that can ruin this for me in the day of judgment. So we should judge Aleph. So whatever that thing that crossed your mind that I need to get right, you better get it right today, Israel, y'all. And I said so many times, it's time for us to stop playing. It's time for us to get real with Almighty Yahweh. Why? Because he is not playing. He is real. Let him that is righteous, and he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is kodesh, that is set apart, that has been set apart unto Yahweh, let him be kodesh still. Let me read a few more verses, if I will, Yisrael. Then let's read on. And behold, I come quickly, Yahshua saying, and my reward is with me, to give to every man according to what his work shall be. So what are our works? Are works of righteousness? Are there works of tzaddik? Have we speaking truth to our neighbor? Have we not lied or killed a person? And killing is more than just you going up and bam, you shooting somebody or you choking. It's more than just that. But as you having an ought against your neighbor, and you're not going to that neighbor, and all is really nothing. Really, we shouldn't have anything against each other, for we are our neighbors, Yisrael. But if you have something against your hope, then the scripture says that you are a murderer. Hallelujah. You speak against your ought and your hope, instead of being one that is in pilah or prayer, that y'all will deliver if that one needs a delivery. Many times we're the one that's needing the deliverance. It's me or y'all standing in the need of prayer. According, he will be judged according to his works or whatever his works should be. Yahshua said, I am Alpha and Omega. Yahweh say, he says here, I'm Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I am the first and last. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have the right to the tree and may enter in through the gates into the city. For without are dogs and scorners and whoremongers and murderers and idolaters and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. So it shows you all those that's going to be left out of the kingdom, out of the Melkut. Hallelujah. So none of these things should rest in our lives or be in us, Yisrael. It says in verse 16, now I, Yahshua, have sent my Melekim to testify unto you these things in the Bayet of Yah. I am the root and the offspring of David, and the bright and the morning star. And the Ruach and the bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whoso will come, let him take the water of life freely. Does you know that Yahweh desires us, Yisrael, to partake of this life, the water of life freely, the tree of life freely, that tree being Yahshua HaMashiach? He desires for us to partake of those fruits, to sustain us, that we may be happy. Don't you know it's his desire for us to be happy, that our joy may be fulfilled, that we may grow in the knowledge of Yahshua HaMashiach, the Dabar of Almighty Yahweh. It is his desire, Yisrael. Hallelujah. He's concerned about our welfare, our situation. But yet he allows us to go through certain things. Why? That we may grow, that we may understand, that we may depend on him. Any father wants his son to depend on him. Is that not true? He wants his daughter to depend on him, that he is the one that provides. He is the one that is able to provide shelter and safety. Any of us will want that. Any father will want that of their children, that their children depend on him. Well, Yahweh desires that of us, Yisrael. He wants that. He wants that. So let us as a house, as a nation, stop fighting against Yahweh. Let us stop kicking against the prick. Let us just give in and give up. Let us submit unto the will of Almighty Yahweh. Hallelujah. For it's for our benefit, Yisrael. Todi Yahweh. Todi Yah. Turn with me to Yochanan. First Yochanan, chapter 3 and verse 1, I want to begin reading. Read a few verses here, and then I want to move on until the last part of this message. Hallelujah. In Proverbs. To the Yahweh. Yahweh is tough, and it's a beautiful day. Hallelujah. Don't you know every day is beautiful? Even though it may be raining, wind may be blowing, but yet still, it is a beautiful, beautiful day. Hallelujah. All right. It says in 1 Yochanan 3 and 1, behold what manner of Ahava, Yahweh's love, that the Abba has bestowed upon us, that we should be called again the children of Almighty Yahweh. Wherefore the world knows us not. Why? Because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the children of Yahweh, and it does not yet appear what we shall be. See, we are the children of Yahweh, even though in many instances you look at yourself in the mirror. Sometimes you may look at those around you and wonder, how in the world is this possible? How in the world did this come to be that I could be called or have the privilege to be called a child of Almighty Yahweh? Your mind goes back on all the things I have done, the things my family have done, what I was brought up in. But yet today I can proclaim that I am beloved of Yah and that I am a child of Almighty Yahweh. That is something to boast about, Yisrael. Hallelujah. That I am a child of the King, the Almighty One, Creator of all things. And not only am I that, but he calls us his children, his flock, and the sheep of his pasture. My. I don't know. That enables me to take the next step, Yisrael. Beloved, now we're the children of Yahweh, and it does not yet appear what we shall be. But we know, do you know that, Yisrael? We know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. And every man that has this hope, what does he do? What should we do if we have this hope within us? We should purify ourselves. We should constantly watch what we do, watch what we say, our actions, and purify ourselves. Even the purest of water is not pure when you compare it to the water that Yah gives, this water of life. You can put all the cold filters in it you want. You can distill it and distill it again. But it does not compare to the pure waters that we shall drink from in the Melkut of Almighty Yahweh. For every man that has this hope in him purifies himself even as Yahweh, even as Yahshua is pure. For whosoever commits sin also commits iniquity. For sin is the transgression of the Torah. So have the Torah, has it been put on the back burner? Do we throw it away? Hallelujah. For sin is the transgression of the Torah. And you know that he was manifest, the Torah, Yahshua, to take away our sins. And in him, there is no sin. There's no corruption. There is no iniquity. Whosoever abides in him, it says, sins not. Are we abiding in the Dabar, the Torah of Almighty Yahweh? Don't you know the Torah of Yahweh is written in the level of Yisrael? Are we abiding in it? Are we seeking with all of our strength not to walk outside the commandments of Almighty Yahweh? Whosoever abides in him sins not. And whosoever sin have not seen him, neither do they know him. There are those that confess that I know Almighty Yahweh. I know him. But yet, in their lives, they're full of sin. They commit sins. They transgress the Torah. So if we say that we love Yahweh, and we do not obey his mitzvah, or we do not walk in his commandments, what does that make us? Liars. Is lying a sin? Yes. Who is the father of all lies? Satan. So does Yahweh give us a dividing line? Does he draw, if I may say, a line in the sand and say, you do not pass over this point? If you pass over this point, you're not mine. You're none of mine. So let's continue to walk into the bar. It's not hard to walk into the bar. You know what makes it hard to walk before Almighty Yahweh? It's because there still yet abides in us sin and iniquity. Because the scripture says that the way of a transgressor is what? It's hard. So let us stop transgressing. Let us stop fighting against Almighty Yahweh. Because the way of a transgressor, it is hard, Yisrael. So let us stop the transgression. Let us stop committing iniquity before Almighty Yahweh. Hallelujah. 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 Let us sing. Let us exalt Abba Yahweh. Come on, let us barak. Let's stand to our feet, Yisrael. Hallelujah. Let us give Todah unto Yahweh for what all he has done. Hallelujah. Barak Yahweh. Praise Yahweh. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Remember where he has brought you from, Yisrael. Hallelujah. Don't you know where he is taking you? Hallelujah. He has washed us from all of our sins, Yisrael. He has cleansed us from all our iniquities. Hallelujah. That we may come before his presence with singing. Into his courts with praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Proclaiming that this is the day that Yahweh has made. So let us rejoice. Hallelujah. Let us be glad in it. But this is his day. This is his Shabbat. Hallelujah, Yahweh. Hallelujah. Toda Yahweh. Hallelujah. 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 Toda Yah. Toda Yah. Hallelujah, Yahweh. Hallelujah. 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 Todiah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may be seated, Israel. Hallelujah. Todiah Yahweh. Todiah Yahweh. Let us continue in Mishlei, Proverbs chapter 24 and verse 1. Hallelujah. Mishlei, Proverbs chapter 24. In verse 1. This is concerning the Tzaddik man that some may talk about, that falls into sin, as some may think. Hallelujah. Falls into iniquity, as some may think. Is that what a Tzaddik man does? A righteous man? Hallelujah. Let us find out. Be not you envious against evil men. You know, if you don't watch yourself, you get into that phase, or you start thinking about how it's seemingly that wicked men, they seem to flourish and have so much. And no matter how much we work or hard work or how many years we put into labor, it seems like we don't amass a thing. We walk in the Torah of Yahweh. Sometimes you may wonder, where are the blessings? Where are the riches? Then you see a wicked man seeming like he's eating better, he's healthier. Hallelujah. And that is true in some cases. The scripture says for us, be you not envious against evil men, neither desire to be with them. We shouldn't desire to be in the company of evil men, of wicked men, those that despise Yah, that hate Yahweh, that despise the Torah. It says, for their heart, it studies destruction. They study destruction. You look at the weapons of warfare that we have in this time and age. I know there are many of you that are here, those of you that are listening, that have been in the military. Even back then, in that time, the weapons of destruction were very powerful, are very powerful. But even today, what has happened? They figured out ways to improve it, to kill more people, to make more destruction, more suffering, have they not? For their heart studies destruction, and their lips, they talk of mischief. Through wisdom, it says in verse 3, through wisdom is a house built. Through wisdom, it says, is a house built. And by understanding, is it established? Is this nation established? Is it built well? Is the nation of the world, are they established? No, they're not. Why? Because the scripture said that sin, iniquity, is a reproach to any nation, any country, any people. So no, the nation, this nation is not established in the Torah. This nation is not a house that is well built through the wisdom of Almighty Yahweh. Verse 4. And by knowledge shall the chambers be filled with all precious and pleasant riches. What are these pleasant and precious riches? Are they what we see? Is it gold and silver? Is it house and land? Is it having a Mercedes or a Maserati? Is it having those things? No, that's not the riches that what this is talking about, Yisrael, concerning Yisrael. Verse 5, a wise, valiant warrior is strong. Yes, a man of knowledge increases in strength. For by wise counsel you shall make your war. And in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. So those that walk after the Mishpah, after the Ruach of Almighty Yahweh, this is how we fight our warfare. This is how we build our house. This is how we are kept and are established. Walking after the Torah of Yah, after the wisdom of Almighty Yahweh. Not doing as the wicked do. We don't study destruction or speak of mischief or how we can overcome another man or take what he has. Verse 7. Wisdom is too high for a fool. He opens not his mouth in the gate. He that devises to do evil shall be called a mischievous person. Isn't that true? Someone that's always trying to sneak, and they're sneaking, they're always hiding things, lying. That's the cloak of a mischievous person. The thought of foolishness is sin. And the scorner is an abomination to man. If you faint in the day of adversity, it says, your strength is small. If you forbear to deliver them, that are drawn to death, and those that are ready to be slain, if you slay, behold, we know not. Does not he that ponders the left consider it? Will not you be judged righteously? If this was an accident, if I may say, if it was not an intent for that person to be slain, don't you think the one that is above Almighty Yahweh would not consider the intent of the left? Do you think he would not know? And he that keeps your nephesh, your soul, does he not know it? Shall not he render to every man according to his works? Should not every man be judged according to his works, according to his intent, what he has done willingly, what he has done in ignorance? Don't you think Yahweh will not judge a man righteously concerning that? Hallelujah. Yahweh is just. It says also here in verse 13 in Proverbs 24. He says, my son, eat you honey. Why? Because it is good. Should we not eat the Torah of Yahweh? Conditions of Yahweh? Shouldn't it, the sweetness of it, cause us to want more of the Torah? Don't you know we should want more and more of Yahshua HaMashiach? As the old song says that he is sweet, I know. Do we know that Yahshua HaMashiach, the Torah of Yahweh, is sweet? He says, my son, eat you honey because it is tough, and the honeycomb, which is sweet to your taste. Verse 14. So shall the knowledge of wisdom be to your soul, or to your nephesh, or to your nephesh, or to your being. When you have found it, then there shall be a reward. Don't you know there is reward when we read, when we study, when we seek Yahshua in the scripture, in the Torah of Yahweh? Don't you know there's a reward for us? Don't you know there's a reward? And it says, and your expectation, it shall not be cut off. How many of you have experienced that as you read in the Torah and it seems like there's a wealth of knowledge that all of a sudden just start flowing in and you want to go further? You may stop at this chapter tonight, but then you're in a rush to begin it the next day or the next time that you come to the Torah. Why? Because there is a reward for you in the Torah. Every time you go back to it, there's a reward. There's an understanding. And then even when you come into the Bible of Yahweh and the message of Yahweh speak, he even bring to light or even to a greater understanding of the things that you did not understand. Verse 15, he says in Proverbs, lay not wait, O wicked man, against the dwelling of the righteous. Spoil not his resting place. Don't you know that's what the wicked try to do? They try to spoil you. You enjoying yourself, they try to spoil it. You can't go here without someone seemingly that they're mocking you because of whom you believe in, Yahshua HaMashiach. Don't you know there were those that used to be here amongst us, Teshuva community? And their every move and their every awakened moment is to say something disgusting or to say something awkward or off the wall about the house of Yisrael. Every chance they get, they have something they want to say, something smart, something sarcastic. That's what the wicked do. They lie in wait. They want us to fall. They want us to stumble. They want us to err. And they want to spoil our resting place where we find refuge, where we live, where we cohabitate. That's what the wicked does, Yisrael. It says here in verse 16, and I want to break this down to us, Yisrael. It says here, Mishlei, Proverbs, chapter 24, verse 16. For a just man falls seven times. Is that what it say? Those of you that are looking at your scriptures, what does it say there? For a what? Just man falls seven times. It doesn't say eight times. It doesn't say one time. 20 times. But what does he do? I don't hear, come on. He what? He rises up again. So a just man, even though he may stumble, he may fall short of the honor of Almighty Yahweh, yet he doesn't stay down. He doesn't continue. What does he do? He shoo. Don't you know when you fall, you get up, that's a type of shoo, a turning or returning, or you're getting back up again. He rises up again, but what does it say about the wicked? Let's read that. But the wicked shall fall into mischief. Did it say he shall rise? Did it say he shall get up? So this is showing us a characteristic of a Siddiq man. If he fall, he rises up. He rises to the occasion. He rises up with understanding, with knowledge, with an experience, with wisdom. Why? Because he gets back up again. When he gets back up again, it's not to fall into the same path. It's not to fall into the same error. It's not to fall in the same way again, because he rises up. Because of the Dam of Yahshua, he rises up. There's a strength that in his bosom that, you know what, I'm going to watch that next time. That should not be. That should not be. So what does he do? He stands in the power and in the might of Almighty Yahweh. He has had an experience. He has learned from that experience. He doesn't go that path again. But the wicked shall fall into mischief. Now, I'm going to break this down and explain this to us, Israel, y'all, so bear with me. Word for word. It says, for a just. In Hebrew, just is tzaddik, tzaddikim. A tzaddik man. A man that is just, he is lawful. He has the Torah. He is lawful. He is righteous. Just, right, whether it be in government or to one's cause or one purpose. He is just, he is righteous in conduct and in character, how he carries himself. You know a righteous man by how he walks. You see one continuously falling in the same debacle, in the same sin, something's not right. It doesn't matter what you say or what you think. You judge a man by what? His works, by his deeds. In his conduct and in his character, he is righteous, he is justified. He is vindicated by Almighty Yahweh, by the blood of Yahshua. Right, correct, lawful. Again, he walks in the Torah of Almighty Yahweh. For a just man falls seven. Sheba in the Hebrew, seven. Seven times. Now, there's a reason for this number. Those of us that know that seven is it's Yahweh's favorite number. It's a number of completion. You start here, just as has he not given us an example on the Shabbat day, the seventh day? You have how many days? 6 days of labor. And then the seventh day, and what does it do? It's completed. There's not an eighth day. There's not a tenth day. It starts at a seven-day week, a seven-day period. It doesn't go beyond, never goes beyond 7 days. I haven't seen a calendar yet that goes beyond what should be the seventh day period of Almighty Yahweh. So in this, it even gives us a glimpse that this is what makes this tzaddik man what? Whole. Complete. Complete in Yah. Complete in Yahshua HaMashiach. Complete in the Torah. What does a wicked man do? He falls into mischief, and he doesn't rise again, Yisrael. So for one that is tzaddik, again, walking in the Torah of Almighty Yahweh, walking in the mishpah of Yahweh, he's doing right. For him to stumble and to fall, he gets back up again. And he learns from that experience. He grows from that experience. He don't go that path anymore. Seven times until he is made complete. So there's situation, there's circumstances that is for our learning, it's for our strength, it's for us to continue to get back up. To continue, you get back up. No, you don't continually fall. You get back up until we are made what? Complete. That is what this is meaning, seven, or shehaba in the Hebrew, seven times. It also says to rise, to stand up, to arise. To become powerful, stronger. That's what this means, seven. Seven times. That doesn't mean a man, he goes out and he continues to sin seven times, because if that's all it meant, then we'll all be damned for hell. There'll be no hope for us all, because we all have exceeded that number if we was counting by number. But that's not the expression that he's trying to express here concerning this tzaddik man. He is made complete. After the seventh time, because it's completion of Almighty Yahweh. Let us go again. Let us continue. He arises. He becomes powerful to arise, to come into sense. Wisdom, understanding, being brought to his senses. When you're brought to your senses, it's because you have not an understanding of a thing. So you're brought to your senses. I understand this thing. You're going to progress. You're going to press on. To maintain one's self. That's what the seven means. That's what it means. Sheheba, to be made stronger. Seven, to get up, to rise, to press on. It's a completion. If I may say, it's to the max completion. It is done. It is finished. It's not a continual, repetitive action. Because if I didn't do it this way, because this is Yahweh, there's many that will take that and use that for a reason or an excuse to sin and to fall. And that the Dama Yahshua will continually cleanse me. That's not how it goes. The Dama Yahshua cleansed, he died for us one time, the blood cleanses you. Now it's time for us to do what this says, to become stronger, to move on, to press on, to become complete in Almighty Yahweh. Hallelujah. You with me, Israel? Yeah. Man falls, Shabbat, seven times. And it says that he rises, he kun. He gets up. He rises. Hallelujah. Getting my pages somewhat confused, Israel, but you understand what I'm saying. Hallelujah. But I want to be on point. Hallelujah. To the Hallelujah. He rises up. He coons. He maintains himself. He keeps himself. That's what coon means. He rises. Let us continue. He rises up again. He fulfills the Torah. He establishes the Torah in his left. And he binds it. He binds with it. He does not depart from it. That's what the meaning is, coon. He does not depart from it. He carries it out and he gives effect, or let the effectiveness, he lets it come forth and to be raised up. So a Tzaddik man, though he falls seven times, he rises up again. But the wicked, the criminal, the Rasha, the guilty one, the one that has committed the crime, the guilty, the wicked, he is hostile unto Almighty Yahweh. He seeks to destroy any link, anything that has to do with Yahweh. That's what the wicked do. They seek to corrupt it, to destroy it. Wicked, guilty of sin. This is concerning the Rasha or the wicked. He shall fall in the Hebrew, kasha, to stumble, to stagger, to totter. You know, when you see a baby or a toddler, that's why they call them toddlers. You see them trying to walk, they stumble, they fall. They really don't have their balance. It says they totter, they stumble. To be tottering or to fumble, or one that is feeble, he is weak. To cause to stumble, bring to injury, to ruin, or to overthrow. That is what the Rasha or the wicked are. That's what they do, Yisrael. To make feeble, to make weak. To be made to stumble. They stumble in, or the wicked, they stumble, or they fall in to mischief and to ra, into evil. They're always doing things that displease Almighty Yahweh. They're disagreeable. That's what evil is. It's always disagreeable, mad, unpleasant, displeasing. Worse than worse. That is something, isn't it? Evil, wickedness. It seems to get worse and worse, or it's worse than worse. It's hurtful. It's unkind. In general, a person of thoughts being unkind or blaspheming, or his deeds or his actions being unkind or wicked. That is what that explains unto us, Yisrael. Hallelujah. That's breaking that scripture down concerning, for a just man falls seven times, and he rises up again, but the wicked shall fall into mischief. So let us not walk after the path of wickedness. Let us not fall into mischief. Let us not exercise mischief. Let's let everything be out in the light. The scripture says that Yahshua, he is the light of the world, is he not? Light has come into the world. Well, what has happened? Men that reject, they hate the light. That's the wicked. Why? Because their deeds and their action are their evil continuously, Israel. Let's continue on into verse 10. Hallelujah. Revelations. Let's go to Revelations, Giliana, chapter 2, verse 10. I want to begin reading. As I bring this message to a close, Yisra'iyah. And I do hope and I pray that you was able to amass a wealth of understanding from this teaching. We may revisit this concerning being born of Almighty Yahweh. But I want us to grasp it, Yisra'iyah. We should be different. We shouldn't be like the world. The world should look at us and not know us. Just like the scripture said, they did not know Yahshua. So because we are born of Yahweh, the world knows us not. We should be different. We should be set apart. Hallelujah. Guyana, Revelation chapter 10, chapter 2, verse 10, I want to begin reading. It says, for none of those things which you shall suffer, behold, the devil shall cast some of you in prison, that you may be tried, and you shall have tribulation 10 days. Be you faithful unto death, unto the state or your last days, and I will give you a crown of life. Do we desire this crown, Yisra'iyah? Don't you know it's an honor to wear a crown? What does a crown signify? It signifies power. It signifies rank. It signifies that you are the one that has the crown is above all. Well, why would he give us a crown, Yisra'iyah? Did he not say, if we will endure faithfully, even unto death, he says that I will give you a crown. A crown. Hallelujah. 11. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Ruach is saying unto the congregation. Do we hear what the Ruach is saying unto the congregation today? That we must be born again. We must be born of Almighty Yahweh. Transformed. Not walking in the desires of the flesh, after the wills of the flesh, doing fleshly things, the things that we used to do. Under to the congregation, he that overcomes shall not be hurt of the second death. So not only is there a second, or there's a transformation or to life, but there's also a second death, Yisra'iyah. What is this second death? Even though you yet live, yet you're dead, even though you yet live, separated from Almighty Yahweh. Let us continue. He that overcomes shall not be hurt of the second death. And to the Melach of the congregation of Pergamos write, these things saith he, which has the sharp sword with two edges. I know your works and where you dwell. Even where Satan's seat is. Don't you know Satan has a seat, Yisra'iyah? Don't you know he has a seat, he has a place? And you hold fast my name and has not denied my faith, even in those days wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you where Satan dwell or where he sits. But I have a few things against you because you have there become that hold the doctrine of Balaam. We should not hold the doctrine of Balaam, Yisra'iyah, that curses Yah, that comes against Yah. It's a doctrine of Satan. Who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Yisra'iyah to eat things that had been sacrificed to idols and to commit fornication. That's what Satan seeks for us to do, Yisra'iyah, to commit fornication against Almighty Yahweh. To throw his covenants that he has made, his promises. Don't you know that's what that is when you're married to one and you express your vows? Those are promises and covenants. Satan wants us to commit fornication, that we turn from all that Yahweh has promised unto us and our promises unto Almighty Yahweh. Verse 15. So have you also them that hold the doctrine of Nicolaitans, which things I hate. He hate the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. Verse 16. He says, repent or else I will come to you quickly and I will fight against them with the sword of my mouth, with the Dabar, with the Torah. He that has an ear, in verse 17, let him hear what the Ruach says unto the congregation. Let us hear, Yisra'iyah. To him that overcomes will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give to him a white stone, a pure stone, a white stone. And in that stone, he says, a new name written. Don't we desire to hold that stone, that white stone, and then look at this new name that has been written? A new name written. It's only going to be to those that have experienced this born again, that have been born of Almighty Yahweh, transformed, which no man knows. No man's going to know it. Only you. You're going to have that stone. No other person's going to know your name. Hallelujah. That no man knows, saving he that receives it. As I bring this to a close, my last couple of verses. And to the Melah of the congregation of Thyatira write, these things saith the Son of Yahweh, who has his eyes like unto flaming fire, and his feet are like fine brass. He says, I know your works, and ahava, and service, and emunah, faith, and your patience, and your works. And at the last, that word again, last, that's a powerful word. And the last, to be more than the first. Hallelujah. So let us, Israel, recognize that Yahweh, he deems us to be Siddiq in this generation, did he not? Was not Noah righteous in his generation? Did not Almighty Yahweh save him and his household? Well, he has deemed us to be Siddiq, Israel, to be righteous in this generation. Why? That we may save our household. Who is our household? You think about that. Yahshua said, who is my mother? Who is my brother? Who are those that are of my family? He said, it is those that do what? The will. Did not Yahshua do the will? That do the will of my Abba. It is those that do his will, Yisrael. Those are your kinsmen. Those are your sons, your daughters, your kinsmen, your neighbor. Those that walk in the Torah of Almighty Yahweh. Yahweh Barak you all. Hallelujah. Toda Yahweh. We do Barak you all that have been listening by via live stream. Again, Reat Dawei, Yisrael, he is in Duluth, Georgia with Zakane Isha, Elder Lewis, hallelujah, and he is conducting the service there. We do ask that Yahweh will continue to barak them there, strengthen them. He has moved, made a move by emunah, by faith, and he's going to continue to walk in the light of Almighty Yahweh, however Yahweh directs him, hallelujah. We do pray that Yahweh would give him the strength that he needs. Hallelujah. And all of you there that are there in Georgia, that are scattered throughout the Olam, Yahweh barak you all. Let us stand to our feet. Hallelujah. Let us turn to the east. Yahweh has commanded that as long as we are here in the Olam, that we should turn unto Yerushalayim. Hallelujah. Offer pilah unto Almighty Yah. But Yahweh, we do barak you for this day that you have made, the Shabbaton. And we have come, Yahweh, on this day to rest. To rest our minds of the labor on the past 6 days, Yahweh. The things that we have experienced or been through, trials, tribulation, Yahweh. We come this day to rest. You have given this day for us to rest, Abba Yahweh. So as we rest, as we think on the message that was given today, that you have spoken unto the house of Israel, Yah, for us to understand, Yahweh, that we are new creatures. We are not the same. We have been made new. We have been transformed in the likeness of Yahshua HaMashiach. So thereby, Abba Yahweh, our desire is to please you in all that we do, Abba Yahweh. Every situation, every judgment that we make, Abba Yahweh, it be to magnify you. And we barak you for all things. We pray that those that have traveled from near and far, you return them home safely, Yahweh, that you're melekim. For we know that they are kept around us, Abba Yahweh. It said in the scripture, as we read today, that they are our fellows, our comrades. Hallelujah. They serve you just as we serve you, Almighty Yah. So allow your melekim to encamp around us, to minister unto us, to instruct us, to encourage us in all things. We do barak you. In the mighty and precious name of Yahshua HaMashiach, we do cry. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Yahweh. Hallelujah. Yahweh, barak you all conditions. Hallelujah.